So, hello, my name's Jake Dugan. My computer is in update hell, so we'll see if we'll get that. So the visual aid might be late or not come at all. But anyway, so my name's Jake Dugan. I work for a company that's an information security firm that specializes in hacking and penetration tests, and I'm part of the red and blue teams, which means I'm part of the defense side and the attack side. So, and the way this panel is going to work is I'll go over a high overview of kind of how we do penetration testing and how we hack into companies and how we break into things. And then kind of, and then at the end, we'll kind of just talk about the ways we see it depicted in gaming, and that there are some that actually do use something similar to the real thing, while others just kind of use a far off fantasy fun version. So we'll do that at the end. So the best way we can start off is we'll go ahead and just define hacking real quick, which hacking is defined as something as like unauthorized access into a computer or a network of computers, obviously. And so, and then hackers are those who do that. Hacking has kind of been a mainstream lately, as you all probably know, of ransomware viruses that say, give us money or you won't get your files back, and stuff like that's been very rampant. That's kind of part of like what the blue team would do, is try to defend against that, and then attackers use that, obviously. So does anyone kind of know what kind of tools are used for hacking in the real world? Anyone kind of played around with anything like that? What?
Kali.
Yes, the Kali Linux, we use that a lot. That's one of our tools. And the red shirt?
Like Aircrack.
Aircrack, yeah. Yeah, so we use like Kali Linux, and we use a PowerShell Empire as well. Which both of those are actually depicted in Watch Dogs 2 recently, that you'll see. That if you look on the computers, that stuff, those programs are actually running around. So with hacking, we kind of do things in four stages. We do in a recon stage, an enumeration stage, then the exploit, and then we do post-exploit. So in our recon stage, whenever we would do hack a company, we kind of we look at all open source materials, so anything that you can find publicly on the internet or any public records. So we'll look for, we'll look at their web pages, see if we can get to their mail login or to their VPN, which is a virtual private network where they, it basically makes a tunnel back to the company's network from anywhere. So we try to look for those pages that are up and out and just see what we can find. And we'll run a tool called Nmap, which scans ports and it finds what services are open, because not all services are secure. So things like HTTP, which is webmail, web traffic, sorry, that's not secure, but most sites now use HTTPS, which is the secured version. We try to find stuff like that that's open, so because there are a lot of exploits out that are out there that can be leveraged. So a lot of people who are really into hacking and programming stuff, they experiment with the software and they try to find loopholes and they try to write to get the computer to execute things. So that's kind of how we use to attack. So, and then from our recon, so I'm sure everyone here uses Facebook and stuff. So we'll look actually, we'll actually try to look up users from the company. So we'll use LinkedIn and stuff like that. And we use all of that stuff to find and kind of enumerate what kind of users we have and what kind of email. There's a tool we use called Simply Email, where we type in the domain of the company and it'll scan like all the email servers out there and tell us what emails there are out there that have been shared out publicly, because a lot of things actually do sell your data off and it's easily catchable. So from that enumeration, how many people here know they have their Facebook set to privately? All right, how many of you know that all of your friends set it to privately? No one? So yeah, see? So that link, we can also just, we will follow the links and try and find out. So when your friend posts on the wall, like, happy birthday, we just now got your birthday, even if you don't share it. Or, you know, like, they say your childhood nickname, and that's like one of your recoverable password questions. So when we find your password reset and we try to find where did you live and where that, so we'll look up your birth records. If you bought a house, we can look up where you bought the house. So we can look at where, those are all publicly available information. So, and then there's like white pages will actually have a lot of data, because there are companies out there that collect your data and they portfolio it out there for people to look up. So it's quite interesting. I highly recommend you just try like go into white pages or try to like search yourself and see what you can find, because it's quite amazing. In our pen test boot camp when I first joined, the instructor said, he's like, here's a sheet of 20 questions. Find out all the things. They're like, what are his kids' names? What is his name? What is his wife's maiden name? Where did they get married? what day they got married, what day's his birthday, where does he currently live, what military bases did he go to, and like all that's, and he's like, what are some blogs he did and what are some of his call signs? And we found a lot. Like we found out his wife's maiden name. They had a newspaper ad about their wedding in her hometown, so we found that, and we knew where then his wife's maiden name because it was in the article. And so just it was just a really eye-opening experience to know how much of your information is actually just out there and shared, because if it's free, you're pretty much the product. Because Facebook and companies like that, they use your data to sell to ad companies and stuff. So, anyone have any questions so far at this level? My computer might come here in a minute. Yes,
the blue. You're mentioning about NMAP. Do you do that on the web server or after?
We'll get our scope we're given from a company. They'll give us like 10 or whatever many IPs they'll give us. Like that scope, that is our defined scope for loss. That's the only thing we'll look at actually that's not publicly facing. So if they give us 10 and one of them is their mail server or something, we'll start probing all those IPs with NMAP just to see what we can get, or we'll run Nessus scanner on it as well. Because we also use Nesses. Hey, 30%, almost there. yeah, we'll look for things like port 80 or FTP or Telnet, all those services that ClearText send things out or stuff that we have really easy exploits in Metasploit, which is designed by Rapid7, which is a fun, it's in Kali Linux, so if you want to play with Kali Linux, you'll get Metasploit, which is a fun little tool. We actually have several of our guys on our team actually develop for Metasploit as well, and they also develop for Empire. They contribute. So you'll see modules from us. And then another tool we run also is Kingfisher. That's actually a free phishing campaign we do, because we also do include email phishing in all of our pen tests now, or especially our external pen tests. So I'm sure how many people have seen phishing emails of like, you won $2,000 and stuff? Okay. Well, I was on a pen test. I sent an email and I mimicked their webmail login. I'm saying, hey, we're upgrading the Office 365. Everything on it was legit, except I told them to enter their passwords. I got one person's passwords. I then looked at their email. And looking at their email, I looked at their calendar. I saw they had a Halloween party that day. And the day was game 5 of the World Series. And the company, this office I was looking at was in Chicago. So I had a little fun. So we had a raffle ticket spreadsheet. It's a spreadsheet you open up and it says, click this button to generate your ticket. So I took it, I threw in the last Chicago World Series banner. I put in our malicious payload that we generate in Empire. It generates a payload, so when they click that button, it would actually drop a shell. So it would drop a PowerShell session that gave me remote access to their computer. So I would then have control of their computer. As much privilege they had. So from there, I then wrote the email, said, good morning, company, Chicago. It's day 5 of the World Series. We're going to win this year, along those lines. And I'm like, hey, so at the Halloween party today, we're going to raffle off World Series tickets for you today. So go ahead and open up, generate your ticket, and we'll announce it tonight at the party. And the email I sent it from, this company did not have an SPF record, which kind of, if you don't have that in place, it doesn't, your mail server will not verify where the email came from. So I just did it from HR at that company. So that way that one person couldn't be questioned. So like everyone who was ever part of that email distro will be like, oh yeah, so-and-so might have sent it or something. Hey, it's up. Everybody clap. Yeah. So I sent them that email, and even I had like a big, it said 2016's our year, like just some stock image I pulled out of Google real quick. But I sent it to them, and then, all right, let's guess, how many people did you think I took over?
Quite a few.
I had 80 in under a half hour. So I had 80 computers under my control. They were coming so fast that I couldn't keep going with anything because it kept, the way it worked, that is, as I typed, it would blip in saying, new agent was given, and it just kept interrupting my typing, and I couldn't keep up with how fast it was coming. So that's kind of like the enumeration. Once I like find out your users, then we tried like an external fish, and then if we could get, or if there was in a way to externally, like, say your web server had a bad admin login, and we could upload then malicious code to it and execute and take control of that server. Once we do that initial attack, like attackward, then we go internally, and then we just do what's called post-exploitation, which is we're gonna look at things like moving laterally through the network and trying to find like maybe the user I took's not an admin, but they might be an admin on another computer, and Windows has this really bad thing called SMB, which we have this thing called SMB login, so we have your credentials. We just send that, and we send that to all the other computers in the network, and it tries to log in, and it'll tell us if the login's valid on that computer, and if you're an admin. So it's basically just a matter of time of finding out where to go. Excuse me. Basically, that it just turns into that of just finding more and then compromising way more stuff, because then we can then upload more code because we have a valid login, so we can log into a lot of different computers. Or if you have an RD remote desktop stuff enabled, we start logging into all of that. So we just start trying to find. And then we also try to find data that we can take out. So this one company that I broke into, they were like a health insurance company, or they had something with healthcare, I can't quite remember. But I looked at this guy as a I took a screenshot, I entered a command for a screenshot, and it came back, and I just saw files, like important healthcare files, are just layered on his desktop for me to like see. And I'm like, we could take that if we wanted. And we could have just sent that to ourselves. So it's pretty, a little crazy how people don't take security seriously, and that's kind of why our industry right now is really good for us. Hang on, let me see if I can get the projector working here. Does anyone have any questions about the post-exploitation or kind of exploiting or like compromises? We'll go with you right here in the front first. No, that's usually our goal, is to capture data and to just, or they'll say get domain admin or capture data or try to compromise this person. So, because the companies are paying us to test their security. So it is not like a black hat at all. It's definitely more white, gray hat area because we're being paid to do it because it's for testing. So it's basically, let's pretend to be the bad guys and then before the real bad guys actually hit you. So yeah, they will know. Usually we're working with their IT teams, and so they're like, okay, we start our testing on this time span, and then we also run IR incident response test, IR test, which we kind of run tandem with pen test, saying, hey, we're going to work with your defense team, we're going to let our attacker attack, so let us know if you see anything. And a lot of time they're like, no, we don't see anything, and we're like, okay, we're like literally compromising half your network right now. Like, we're making as much noise as we can. We're running Bloodhound right now, which if you don't know what Bloodhound's a tool that once you have a valid login, it'll spider through the network and it'll tell you every user login and it'll tell you what path you have to take on what computer to get to the domain admin. But it's very loud and it's easy to see. Not seeing the HDMI recognize. Tech crew, yes, thank you. All right, I'll take another question. Yes, back in the black, not you, but right behind him. Yeah, yes. And then you're next, you're next. Okay.
How often do you not break into a network?
I think our company has about an 80% chance of breaking in. That's usually externally. Usually internally, we always win, no matter what, because we're already past that external phase and we do internal testing. And internal companies don't usually focus as much attention on their internal stuff as compared to their external. And what the internal testing kind of represents is a employee or a contractor gone rogue, or if somebody walked in and just plugged in right into the network. And then we also do physical testing, so we'll try to physically break into buildings too. And then we have red teams, which is literally a combination of everything of social engineering, of emailing, trying to physically walk in. I'm not seeing it detect.
Is this Windows 10?
Yes. Click this one. Yeah.
And then, project. Yeah. Duplicate. Okay,
It says it, so you probably just got to... Almost there. Maybe. All right, we'll go ahead to your question, then we'll get to over here. If we do, we do do bug bounties in 0 days like that, so we'll usually use them privately, and then we'll report them to the respective, like, software developers, and then it's kind of up to them to when we're allowed to release it, because it is their software. And usually they like to build a fix before they release the 0 day. But if sometimes they don't care, then it's like, but we can't really, since we're a company, we can't really, like, we don't really release those publicly right away, unless, because of all the stipulations and legal with that. Right over here. Yes, we actually have sometimes. I know one guy, he actually found somebody new that started that day, and they had two-factor. So he literally, he got his password because he knew their login password, like for the new hire. So he literally set up his phone for the two-factor before before that guy could. So he used the two-factor to get in. And then I've done companies where I literally, like, I might have had, like, VPN mess up, but we found, like, their inventory, so we had their computer name. So I called them, and I'm like, hey, this is my computer. I'm so-and-so. And they're like, wow, you have the same area code as that guy. I'm like, yeah, it was lucky for me. And they were, people are amazed when we start calling them, too, and doing vishing, which is voice phishing, which we also, I did one recently. We pretended to be from HR. And we asked them to give me the last four of their social. I got them to give me their address, their name, phone number, significant other, an emergency contact, quite a few bit of information just to see how willing they were. And we got about half of them challenged us. The other half didn't. So it's quite interesting what you can see. Didn't detect another display. Dun, dun, dun. Usually it blips, if you know. Yeah. Let's do it. No, thanks. Go away. Yeah. Do we have any more questions? I'll keep answering while I'll go right here, because I know you were up for... usually the on-prem is a little bit easier to break into, I think, just from my preferences, just because it's on-prem, so if they don't update them or anything, they're in charge, while the cloud, they're a little bit harder because, and it's also a little more gray area since they technically don't own those servers. It's then a question of, can we even attack that area? Because it could be out of scope because it's Google stuff, so we can't just go attacking Google's items while, even though the company owns the stuff on it, because sometimes those cloud services, they share resources, they, like, multiple companies are on the same stuff. Yeah, let's try VGA. This side too. And we have one over here. Yeah. I'm not too big. We do have a few guys. There we go. Yeah, I know. It's most convoluted HDMI. So I haven't had to write anything yet, but some of our guys are really good at scripting, so they will. And like I said, we have dudes who do develop for the tools, Metasploit and stuff, so they will, like, if we go to them like, hey, I'm trying to do this, they're like, oh, I think I got an idea, and then they write a tool or something real quick, and we try it out. Because we have our own R&I team that do that. I haven't personally written anything yet, really, because I'm coming more from, I came from more of a defense side thing, so more networking, so I'm still newer to the attacking side, but we do have dudes who do write their own scripts on the fly a little bit, but it does take them out, because Our average pen testing time is 16 hours, so that's 2 days of work for pen testing. So it's not like what you see in gaming that's like, oh, done. Like, it's a lot more complex than that. Up here in the front. Yay, it's working. All right, we can go. So go ahead. We'll keep doing some questions, and then I'll talk about the pictures here. Yeah, go ahead. I know a lot of viruses and stuff like that are written in a C sharp and C plus, while our guys in our house, they're strictly all Python, and then the Empire PowerShell is all strict PowerShell. So PowerShell is very handful for also defense and attack, but then Python's also a very versatile language. I went and learned a little Perl, but that's not as common. Yes, it is Ruby. Yeah, Metasploit is Ruby gems, so Ruby's a good one too. And that's why you see the viruses are written in those languages as well, just so because that's like a lot of the ransomware is C sharp and stuff like that. So, and then Kapersky analyzes it, obviously. I'll go ahead and talk about these pictures here. So this is from our pen test boot camp, so I'm allowed to talk about because it's all Star Wars themed. So there's actually no, like, this is our in-house lab that we play around with. This bottle one right here, this is the nmap scan of the open web server. So you can see we have only 443 and then an HTTP proxy open. And then this top one is 401 unauthorized. We flag for default errors because default errors on stuff can tell us a lot of information. So it'll tell us the version of Apache, and sometimes it, like, this talks about like secret and the manager, and it talks a little bit about the directory structure. So we can then use that information, even though we're not getting anywhere, it gives us information about this. And I think on this one of the pages literally said a username at the top by accident, and that's how we started doing our brute force attacks, which that's part of exploitation too. Like, we do brute forcing is, you know, take one username and we'll try password, 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 different passwords. We do reverse brute forcing because we find it more successful, where we'll take from our enumeration stage, we find all those users and we have all these usernames, right? And then we'll try one password with the, like, say we had 1,000 users, we try one password with those 1,000 users, the chances are much higher that we're going to get in by trying more users than just one user with more passwords. Yes?
What's the common password you use?
I like to start off with password 1 because that's just super easy. Also, a good one to do is just the user as password. People just put their username as their password. Or we'll do things like fall 2016, whatever season it is currently, because people will change their password to the season and like year. So we'll do winter 2017 now soon. Or if they're in like a major NFL like city, we'll try like maybe their sports team with a number, or we'll try 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We try various things. We have like several password lists of like 15,000 passwords too that we could run if we have a lot of time. We can put it in our, we have one system that's a dedicated hash cracker and a password cracker that it goes to town on attacking passwords. Right here, this one's right here. This is it. This is the username up here on the top. It's hard to see. It says Antilles Wedge is the name. So it's all Star Wars themed. So the guy who made it was Star Wars based. So that's how we got our first username. So then we went and looked up more Star Wars characters, and we started compiling a list of Star Wars character names so we could do a reverse brute force. And then one of them had password 1 as their password, which was Poe Dameron. And then in Poe Dameron, we found their webmail. So Poe Dameron had an email from another admin saying, hey, our Tomcat, this is the password to get into the Tomcat server. So once we had that Tomcat info, we could log into the Tomcat server, and we'll test to make sure the login's still valid. That top one is, what is that? Oh, that's NTLM. So we took the mail server. It's not really a thing you can fix, but it hits the webmail server, and then it'll give us the domain name that they use internally. So then we know, like, when you type my company / your username, we now know that part. So this was HackMe was the domain name that we used that was in use. So from that email, we tested and we could get into the Tomcat server. So we are able to successfully log into the server with an admin credential. So, well, from this side, we can't do anything. Metasploit has a Tomcat manager credential upload module in it. So all I had to do was we fed it the Tomcat credentials up there at the top. And then when you hit run, it goes through its process and it dropped a shell, an interpreter shell, on that Tomcat server, and I now had admin level access on that box. So, and then from there, we would then do our lateral movement and try and move throughout the network by doing, we dump hashes because you can also, you don't even need the password sometimes to log in. If we have the hash, we can actually just feed the hash to the computer and the computer will accept the hash as the password. Or, and then we also ran Mimikatz and we actually pulled all the passwords from memory because Windows has a really bad thing that if you don't turn the computer off, it'll have everyone's password who's logged in on it still. So a lot of your servers and stuff that doesn't go down a lot usually has passwords logged into it. So we were able to find out K-Fisto really likes water. The admin says, never change me. I think Obi-Wan Kenobi was crazy old space wizards. And then, so we just basically did that. So we had, oh, Padme Amidala had one Anakin one. So for what we did with Padme is we did SMB log on against the rest of the scope network we had. Yes?
Is there memory
in Yeah, you can pull it out from clear, yeah, memory in clear, yeah. Yeah, so Windows does that notoriously. They fixed it with 8.1 and above and 2012 server above. So if, for those of you who are like, oh no, Windows 10, actually it still can happen, but you have to change a registry. So we have to have some other way of holding on to the computer without, before we can change that and then run the Mimikatz. So we would have to have like your RD, your remote desktop access so we could then redo everything. So with that, with Padme, we did the SMB logon. So we just kept giving IPs with Padme's credentials, be like, hey, what's Padme an admin of? And then, hey, Padme's an admin of 10.1.1.161. So we then logged into 10.1.1.161. We pulled the passwords from ClearText. And you can see here that we have admin M. Mothma, who has Rebel Scum as her password, and she's the domain admin of the whole network. And then at that part, at that point, when we have domain admin, that basically means we have control of anything because we have the highest level access you can have on a network. So we could log in into anyone's stuff. We can pull anything we want out of anyone, log into any server. So that's kind of one of our ultimate goals. If we don't do data exfiltration, we'll do domain admin. So that's kind of a high overview real quick over how kind of hacking's done in real life. It's a lot of time consuming. And while we're pen testers, we actually have limited time. So we actually rush things or we don't have enough time to do things we want to do compared to real hackers who have a lot more resources and a lot more time and they're a lot more patient than we are and they do more man-in-the-middle type attacks as well. So that's kind of a high overview of kind of how pen testing and real-life hacking works if anyone else has questions. And then we'll get to the fun part. Yes, in the back. It's kind of in our statement of work that we do testing from this day, and then after your testing day is over, we do cut off. We have to, because by this contract, we are obligated to cut off all of our testing. We kill, and it's in our proposals that we don't retain your data that long. Like, we have a set day to retain data, and we securely secure data. We have a secure point where we put all the information so we don't email anything between our companies. We have a secure SharePoint portal that they have to two-factor into, and they drop the stuff they give us, and then we drop our findings there, and then our data is to be wiped. Our exploit boxes, we wipe everything. We send out little boxes for scanning. Every time we get them back, they're instantly completely re-imaged and wiped to get rid of all data. We don't hold on to data unless it's agreed upon mutually by both companies about a set time. Because legal, but yes. I would definitely start with Kali Linux and just go to Metasploit. They have a Metasploit Unleashed that has a full overview on how Metasploit works. And then try to get some VMs up and just kind of spin up your own little lab of stuff and build exploitable machines yourself or find machines that are to be exploited and then just kind of testing on yourself because you can't, you cannot, whatever I taught you or you learned, don't do your powers for bad. Like, do only things you're legally allowed to do. So only do things on your own in-house labs or stuff that you're allowed, like you build a bunch of old computers and try to break them yourself. So that's where you would want to start. Yes, in the hat in the back. We did one not too long ago. I was unavailable to jump in because some of our guys really don't want to do it too much because they'd rather spend their time learning and like developing new things than just trying to do a CTF because we're regularly pen test. But some of them do CTFs. We actually host our own CTF that's coming up. We're going to host it at the University of Pittsburgh this year. It's going to come up in the spring. So, and it's open to high school and college kids. So, some of them do CTFs. A lot of times he doesn't really want to do them. He wants to just develop. He's really big in the coding and programming, so he'd rather just start developing new things. So that's kind of where we're at. So it's kind of whenever we want to or not, because we are a company, so you can't really like go as a company to do it. So it's kind of more recreational level for us. So anything else, and we'll start talking about hacking and gaming. Yes, in the back. I haven't done too much with mobile. We do have a mobile guy, so. I haven't done much mobile testing. That's not part of my skill set, unfortunately. So my skill set's most blue and then more external, internal, and social engineering. All right, so fun part. Let's take a look at how we see it depicted in gaming. We're not going to talk about movies, TV shows, or anime, unfortunately. I realize I should have expanded that, so future versions of this panel will do that. But right now, we're just going to go strictly games. We'll kind of go over some overview of some things real quick. And then at the end, we have time left. We can keep talking open panel about it. So obviously, the first one's going to be Watch Dogs. Big, big, big surprise. I don't know if you can see it, but on that computer screen in this, they actually have Metasploit. And there's another one I had somewhere that I didn't put in that has Empire PowerShell running it. So those are actual tools that they have in the game. On the screens and stuff running, but yet in the game yourself, you really don't. You just go phone, go. So that's Watch Dogs. And then I bet anyone want to guess the next one? Hey, someone. Yeah, Deus Ex is another. Most cyberpunks are going to have some form of hacking probably depicted in their game. So Deus Ex has their, and most of the time, they're also always mini games. So while they're not close to what hacking is, there are actually a few games that we'll get to later that are actually about hacking, and they're kind of more closely rooted, which is really odd, but I thought it was really cool when I was looking into it. So Deus Ex has hacking, but doesn't quite work like that, as I showed you before. Hey, look, CNN. I didn't know I accidentally pulled the Russian hacking, but so yeah, Fallout, little code cracker, password guess. Is quite fun. Kind of what you see is kind of what stuff you will see happen in the modules running and stuff, and in like payloads. So that's kind of cool that they kind of did something like that. But otherwise, obviously, you don't just click and guess twice and you win. It takes a lot more time than that. But obviously, gaming, you can't spend 8 hours trying to break it yourself. So another one is also another big one, but it's early 2000. Enter the Matrix. The cheat screen is actually really close to like web directory and root and guessing things, which that's kind of cool that they have like something really similar to what you would actually do to get like a Keanu Reeves voice file talking to you or car fighting simulator, stuff like that. So Enter Matrix has some really good depiction of that right there. So that's kind of a little closer to the reality than to the non-reality. I don't know why I'm coughing. So yeah, that's where like that.
And then something, a personal favorite of mine, kind of probably why the whole reason I got into computers was probably when I watched Digimon back in the 90s as a kid, and everything was like digitized, and all of the monsters were .mon files. I didn't have that epiphany until I was older. I'm like, oh my god, they're all .mons. That's why they all ended mon. It's their extension. But no, if you played the newer Digimon Story Cyber Sleuth on the Vita and PS4, like the whole premise of it is hackers are the people who can use Digimon programs because they're used to hack the digital world they're in, which it's not realistic at all, but it's just kind of cool. They had like firewalls that were just barriers, but it was still a funny thing to look at, and it gave me a good chuckle because like as I started this job, I was like, oh, I'm actually going to be like a cyber detective and a hacker, and I was like, yeah, it's funny. But that was fun. So Digimon's always had a special place. And then this one gets mentioned a lot in a lot of things I research, and I always was just really confused by it. But Bioshock, Pipeline Dream. I was like, oh, yeah, I guess that's right, but that's more like being a really good plumber on the spot. But okay. When you're steampunk, I guess hacking only means plumbing. So, it's kind of far-fetched because, it's not dream pipe and it's not with water. Unless we're going to just talk about cooling systems, but I thought it was funny. Uplink is kind of one of the more examples to the real thing. It kind of wants you to spread and go around, move around a network, and build up your systems and your power. So that one's really cool to check out. That's on Steam, I think. I haven't played it myself yet, but if anyone else has played Uplink or knows about it, feel free to definitely raise your hand and give a shout out. Go with a shout out. I don't care. Yeah, you do your DigitalOcean and spoof around your IP. Yeah, so it's got some real, like, theory about it and real, like, process to it, which is kind of cool. Yeah. We had one guy, you know how like the new Amazon Echo and everything's going to like control your house with all this stuff. So our guy started experimenting with, like, they reprogrammed their own like dot, and they're like, hey, you could kind of take over someone's house. Or another thing that's concerning that I found out is that the smart fridges that have the smart panels in them, those actually have a really relaxed security on them, and people were able to exploit those smart panels on the smart fridge and then use that to pivot into your network, on your home network. So basically, if it connects to your network at home, it can be exploited, it can be used. What'd you have over here, guy? Yeah, so, and just remember that if your password sucks for your home Wi-Fi, technically, anything on your home network, anything malicious done, you will get fined or arrested for, because you are in charge of that network and you're supposed to maintain security of that network yourself. So make sure your stuff's really good. Yes. Our password recommended password is 12 length and usually in a phrase, and uses a uppercase, lowercase number, and a special characters. That's usually what we recommend on average, but always more is good. So. We had a guy who used song lyrics. He had a 58-character password because he typed song lyrics out in the whole thing. But spaces, but the fact that a dictionary attack won't think like that, though. Well, yes, it might be dictionary words, but a dictionary and a rainbow table would have a hard time, too, interpreting. Because I think his password, I think in bits, that was like, it was like 456 bits. So it was pretty secured. Yes. No, we haven't, because we haven't done too much globally yet. We do have a really large dictionary, like we have a large word list that we compile and make. So we have, I think it's like 85,000 words right now of most common things, because we're going, most hackers do go relatively EV, so like water, take the easiest flow path. And then obviously if we start hitting walls on things, we usually end up just fishing. Because fishing is the, because the human element is the hardest thing to keep secure. It is the only thing you can't secure. It requires lots of attention. Man, we love the, see, we love this past holiday season because we just do, look at these coupons. Use the coupons. So yeah, we don't offer you $1,000. We just say, hey, here's a gift card to Home Depot. Take it. Click it. Please click this file. It's totally... We have an image that we float around in our chat, and it's just a dolphin says, I'm totally not a virus. Please don't click me. We're like, yes, we should just do that. So Uplink, yeah, I thought it was a really good example, closer to the... And then HackerNet actually will teach you some Linux commands, actually, too. So a lot of things are done in Linux, so obviously. So I really, HackerNet was another good one I saw, I found out about, that's really good and really close to what you would see. And there's also a few more out there, but so yeah, we got about 15 minutes left. So if anyone's played HackerNet, please shout out, but probably not. It seemed, it came out this year, so it's really underestimated, apparently. Anyway. Or if you have any other examples I want to talk about, please feel free to enlighten everyone. Yeah, great feedback. DeerBuster is a tool we use that we use on web servers to go through their directories and try to find what directories they have so we can find out, okay, this says this word, and this usually means really good stuff is in it. Yes, right here. Yes. That... We... a lot of them don't like to use Nessus. They like to use Nmap right away. It's a little bit quicker. But once again, externally, we don't usually have a large scope because externally they usually have about 10 to 15, so it doesn't take long. But that's the our normal scoping. Sometimes we'll take more depending on how much they have or how much they want us to do. Or, yeah, that's our just minimal for our pen testing is 16 hours. You go in the back. We do all because, yeah, we do physical. So obviously when we are on site trying to physically break in somewhere, we'll have to talk to guards or talk our way through things. Or we always, a lot of us always take pictures if we see people's badges. Like you walk out in public with your badge and we see people just standing there like waiting to get their lunch and their badge is just hanging off. We'll quick and take a picture of it just in case we ever need to use a badge like that because you're out in public. So we take pictures. So we are all required to take our badges off. As soon as we leave the door, everyone take our badges, take your ba- or we take our badges off because of that reason. I haven't done too much of the physical yet. I just started entering that realm of everything. But I've heard some really funny things of, like, people climbed a drain pipe to get up there, or they got caught and they got mad about the guy, so they went back at night to break in, and they just left their all their business cards right on top of his desk, and then they like waved at the cameras as they walked out. Oh, we had somebody he was at somewhere, and he was in the ship, and he's like snaking, like crouch walking underneath all the trucks and trying to find out where he needs to go. And we have blankets that you throw over the barbed wire and hop the barbed wire, and he's like on the roof, and he's like, this was a really dirty room, there's like stuff all over the wall, he's like, someone looked like they got murdered there, and I wanted to take that helmet. There was one guy who used to always take cones like off the city street, and then he's like, and they're like, what's the cone for? And he's like, oh, don't worry about it. But so our social engineering we'll also build a USB device drop. So we'll load malicious things, or we'll put things, and it'll be like spring break photos 2016, or people getting laid off this year, don't open unless you have the right, or CEO's personal files, and we'll just go to the place and drop them on site and see if people will pick them up. Good. I wonder what's on it. And then obviously phishing, voice phishing, and phishing. We haven't done much smishing where we send text messages with payloads, so mostly a lot of phishing and voice phishing. Yes, right here. It is a lot of it. I come from like the IT admin side, so more defensive. So obviously if you know how to defend against things, you can reverse that and attack as well. So But I'm right now, I'm fulfilling, going more into the taking over the defense, and our lead defense guy, he's going to go more attack, but I also do a little side attack and social engineering, because it's actually quite interesting to see, and kind of getting how to understand the attacks also helps you with defense, so more of a yin yang thing. But obviously, yes, programming, and I started picking up Python myself too, just to learn to do that and get it involved with that. So it's a nonstop thing to learn. So yes, programming definitely will help you, and also just learning basic networking defense skills as well also is very helpful. A lot of our programmer guys are come from like military background where they were defenses in the military, and then they switched to the attack when they got out. I'll hit one over here, right here. Thinking they are secure when they're actually not. Because not knowing and thinking that it's okay to leave things and not update things is also bad. And then also just people thinking they can't be phished, because the real fishes are the things that you don't see all the time of, oh yeah, that's totally not the Nigerian prince. It's like the, oh, hey, someone's like, needs help. Or I like to do too. I scare a lot of people. These one company had a Dropbox, like, hey, send me a secure attachment. And I'm like, I posed as a person. And I'm like, here, checked out. Can you check this file out for me? And it was a real file they had that I went and made it malicious. And 5 minutes after, they took that link down. And I'm like, so, and I asked them, like, why'd you take that then? Like, well, nobody ever tried to do that before, and now you did. Now we can't use it anymore. I'm like, oh, sorry. What else was, there's other good things. There's just a lot of people think they're not fishing, and we fish people. That will come, they fished our point of contact one time and got them and just broke in with their password, too. It was funny. So usually it's the human element's the biggest mistake. Over here, we have that. Yeah, you can do that. Even if I did one and I failed pretty bad for my first time, but they started talking about their procedures and everything. Even I didn't even ask for anything. Like, oh yeah, it's kind of weird. Usually you guys come before 5, and usually you guys have a ticket from this company. So I then relayed that to the rest of the team since I got burned and I couldn't do myself again. They went in with their fake ticket, and then they even got further because that the information that was just revealed to me without them thinking, I went ahead and passed it along. So having those good people skills, and also doing that open source intelligence I said before, so like researching the people, like, oh, I'm here to see so-and-so, we're going to go for lunch or something, and seeing, or like if we have a badge that we made the fake, but obviously it can't scan in, like get behind somebody and tailgate them and just look like you're supposed to be there and like try it, and if they don't notice you didn't beep, just act like it, or if they do, be like, I don't know what's wrong, and they're like, all right, just go in and go to HR and go take, and then never go there, obviously. We had one person who went up and they pretended to like apply, and then like, well, where's the bathroom? And the bathroom was like behind the guard desk just enough, so they pointed her and they left. She went and she changed into like the employee outfit, walked out, and then tailgated her way in. So it takes a lot of recon, especially with the physical side, so they'll spend a lot of time like looking at where are the cameras, where are the entry points, what is the guard, what is their temperament usually, how do they interact with people, when is a good time, how many people come out during lunchtime, how many people go in during the morning, how many people leave at night, where you look for those transitional periods to see where you need to go. After that Chicago thing, I got a call from the company, can you not do that? We have a really angry HR department in Chicago. Oh yeah, we do that. Yeah, that's part of what we do, like when we, after we attack and stuff, we obviously report and we're like, this is what you need to do. If you need help, we can help you do that. We can train you. We do have our Kingfisher, we run, you can do like quarterly campaign training, and like we got like pages like, oh, you've been phished, this is what you need to look out for. And to help, we also help with all that security training, just to help, because that's our goal, is to help people get a lot better at their security. That's the end game, is to make everyone more secure. Yes. So, I read something about something like one of the best things is to make people feel awkward or embarrassed, because when people feel awkward or embarrassed or like, oh, I don't want to be part of the situation, they're more willing to get that resolved and not think about it. And that's why you see a lot of people, that it was with banks, that's why a lot of people's information get, because someone pretends to be someone at the bank, and you have like a crying baby, and you get the baby to go off really crazy, and then you're like, oh God, and then they're like, oh, let me just help you, here, let me just do it for you real quick, and the people don't think because the situation has turned awkward or embarrassing, and it's like, get away, please. Or another thing is like, we'll walk, and then like, people, if you like, we'll look if people in the eye, smile, say, hey, how's it going? People are like, oh, like people avoid confrontation for some reason. So if you just, once again, you act confidently and like you're supposed to be there and like try to engage people, people will just like try to stay away from you, which is weird. Now, there are some that do have good things. Like, we have some that are, like, they had, like, two-factor, and, like, we couldn't because they had it to their phone, and, like, as soon as you tried to reset it, it went right to their phone, and some people instantly contact people, and then it shuts us down, or they'll see us probing. It varies. Your mileage may vary depending on, it really is depending on how the company takes security seriously and how well the IT team does prepare. Any other questions? We have 8 minutes. Yes. I like Kaspersky because they are the ones who, whenever a new like ransomware or anything comes out, they will analyze it. And they bought Malwarebytes did bought that guy. Malwarebytes is also a good one because they bought a ransomware guy. I use Malwarebytes. The Windows default, like the new Windows security thing that comes actually all right. I mean, that's what I use too.
I think we use McAfee on our work computers. We have a McAfee. So it really depends on what you prefer on how it – just no Norton. God, I hate Norton. Yes, in yellow. Norton. I saw an ad the other day. It's like, PC-matic. Do it now. I'm like, what the – this is like the worst like – rant. This is like the worst – ad phishing thing I've ever seen, and I was like, no. Looks like cancer for my computer. Please, no. Yes?
How often do you get into a network and find out somebody's already in there? Somebody who couldn't.
I don't know that statistic. We have seen evidence of people have been hit before. Obviously, we've been like, yo, you've obviously been hit already. Like, look, we found this, and we find traces. Our IR stuff's condensed because IR work does take a lot more time to work. It usually takes months and weeks, and we don't have the IR staff to do that. So our IR is very limited, but we do see, you can obviously see evidence of people who leave their traces behind. Or people will call us like, hey, I've been hit, what do we do? And we'll subcontract that out, or we'll send someone out to analyze and take a look at things like, oh, this is how they got in. This is where it's at. Here's the timeline for you. Because once they've been hit, it's a little too late. It's the only thing you do is prepare for the next one. Yes.
You said people that leave a trace. What does that look like?
They obviously, you can see ports, or they'll sometimes maybe leave files or take files. You can look at when files have been modified, because some people don't take a look at that. So you can see when it was last modified, or and be like, hey, did this person, or it doesn't, things don't add up when you can see. And we have, there's IR software that can analyze, and you can see like traces and things, because nothing's ever deleted on a computer unless you fry it. All right, is there anything else? Thanks for coming, and hope you guys have a good MAGFest.